There you go. That'll be in the next newsletter. All right, thank you very much. And can I ask all of you to raise your right hand, please? Do you solemnly swear or affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, and to answer council member questions honestly?
I do.
Yes, I do.
Okay, let's start with Mr. Robeson, and then we'll go to Mr. Chisholm, and then we'll go to the students, okay?
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Councilman Drum, I'm definitely glad to be here to talk about this issue regarding bullying, harassment, discrimination in New York City schools. The testimony is out there, but I'll just highlight some of the important points because this obviously is an important issue. Although I'm the vice president currently for Career and Technical Education High Schools, my former hat was the director for school safety and health for the United Federation of Teachers. So this topic is not foreign to me, but it's also an important topic. Just in general, when we think about the major cultural shifts that has happened in society around the awareness of gender identity as well as gender equity, many of our schools obviously become the focal point of that. We know that more and more students are identifying themselves in terms of being gay, lesbian, bisexual, et cetera, and they're also doing it at a younger age. It was nice to hear the department talking about going down further to the middle schools in terms of the awareness. In doing so, though, when we think about these societal changes, it also has an impact when it comes to the students and creates untold challenges that we have to collectively address, which was talked about as well. And these challenges also think about threatening the safety, the health, and the well-being of many of the students who come to school to get an education, but impacted by other things. One thing that we know at the UFT is that many educators struggle, as well as counselors, as much as they want to do the right thing, they actually struggle. Even though they want to treat students fairly, they want them to be treated equally and respectfully, but they also, as you heard, struggle with what does that look like? How do they manage to create that environment? And what do they need to do to ensure that that takes place across the board? There's shining examples of schools that are doing some incredible work. If we think about in Staten Island, Newdorp High School, where there's two teachers and a paraprofessional who organized the GSA in their school and bringing folks together to support that conversation. If we think about the Earth School in the East Village, where teachers of fourth graders and fifth graders, and they're talking about rights movements, not just civil rights. It's all of this, and it's done through an inquiry process where students are researching and having fun gathering information, but this is all part of the educational process. When we think about the historic Harvey Milk School and the work that they've been doing in terms of the life's work, in terms of making sure that folks are not just aware, but bringing folks together to have these kinds of conversations. So it's great that there's quite a few efforts, but we know that there's a lot to do. In terms of the UFT, we've done training. In terms of the DASA that was mentioned, we've trained over 12,000 educators in that space. We've also talked about the visibility on how the language that's happening in schools. We touched on it, and Councilman, you touched on it in terms of how people speak within the schools. We have a positive learning collaborative where teachers and staff members and others have intensive training to help students deal with their feelings of frustration, anger, as well as rejection and ultimately depression, and we know how that can lead ultimately to sometimes suicide, which is a tragedy. Also, we have a Brave, building respect, acceptance, and voice through education, a Brave campaign where there's a hotline where folks can pick up the phone and call when they have issues, because that is part and parcel that was raised. How does parents, how does students, how do they know what to do and when to do it and who to call, and it's a confidential hotline. So as much as there's some great work, and I commend the Department of Education on their Herculean effort, one of the things that we have to think about is that there's still more work to be done. We have to continue to build awareness, build understanding, not just among students, but also among, I say, our colleagues and staff, and deputize everyone in this effort. We cannot divorce ourselves from the politics in terms of how do we look at these issues to make sure that we have legislation, make sure that we have regulations that support the students that go to school every single day, and how do we provide the intensive training that we know that everyone needs, not just the students, not just the teachers, but the parents and all of us, so that as collectively we can ensure that every single school is a safe and learning environment for students, that regardless, that they all are able to flourish through their education. And that should be our primary focus. So in doing so, at the UFT, we work with the Department of Education. We're happy to continue to work with the council to ensure that all schools are doing what needs to be done, and I always say, and doing the right thing for our children and by our children, to ensure that parents are confident that the school system is a place that's a safe haven for their schools as we engage in educating them on a regular basis. So we continue to want to work with the council as well as the department and others in this important work.
Mr. Robeson, you mentioned the Positive Learning Collaborative. Can you just give me a couple of details? What is that about exactly? And how does that apply to anti-bullying?
So in general, when we think about what we've done in terms of the Positive Collaborative, it's really about how do you change the culture of a school? And understanding that it's not just how do you train teachers, it's how do we get the entire school community to think about what's in the best interest of students, and how do we do that with a positive focus, and how do you deal with many of the issues that students bring to schools that we need to be able to address, and how do we specifically address those particular issues through training, through and when I say training, I don't want to boilerplate it, because when you hear the word training, not all training is the same. It's an extensive training where everyone in the school community has bought into the training. There's folks from a variety of fields that are coming in to engage in this work. So it's not just in isolation where it's one person just standing up and saying, this is what we need to be able to do. But folks are really engaged in the process in terms of how do we deliver the kind of change that we want to see in terms of a supportive environment.
And there's one person in the school. How many schools is it in with the UFT?
In the Positive Learning Collaborative, I don't have that number, but we've expanded it, and I know that we put resources and others have put resources in it for its expansion over to more schools.
And it's similar to restorative practices, am I right on that?
It is. When you think about the restorative practices, brings all of it together in terms of sociology, not just one thing.
And I don't think I heard in your testimony any mention of BRAVE. Does the BRAVE program still exist?
BRAVE program is still exist. We love the program. It's one where building respect, acceptance, and voice through education. That program has been around for several years. It's been supported by the council. Funding historically has been provided so that there's someone 24 hours a day that they can pick up the phone when it needs to be, and to be able to.
So it's an anti-bullying hotline.
Yes.
Okay, that people could call if they're being bullied.
Yes, and also we also do BRAVE workshops. That's training that goes on with the schools. It's part and parcel with the Department of Education Respect for All. We've engaged in that initiative, but at the same time we fold in our BRAVE campaign and program in that as well.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Chisholm.
Good afternoon, Chairperson Drum and members of New York City Council Committee on Education. My name is Harvey Chisholm, and I'm the Executive Director of South Bronx Community Charter High School. My school is a brand new high school that just opened this year with an inaugural class of ninth graders. I actually have some of my students here with me today. And in my role as Executive Director, I'm responsible for ensuring that both the needs of my staff and students and with regard to access to resources are met, and that we do that in a way that helps us realize our mission of improving the life outcomes of students, but specifically promoting their excellence through a focus on personal, academic, and professional skills in a supportive and responsive learning environment. So South Bronx Community Charter High School serves predominantly Black and Latino students from the neighborhoods surrounding Community School District 7. Our school was inspired by work that was originally undertaken under the auspices of the city's Young Men's Initiative to improve the life outcomes of young men of color. And though this work was the catalyst for our school model, a South Bronx Community Charter High School and our partnering district schools, which include Epic North, Epic South, and the Nelson Mandela School for Social Justice, are all co-ed schools. Collectively, our four schools are enjoying and sharing best practices and really share a common vision for success for our students. And jointly, we provide programming for students who have historically been marginalized and are underserved, and typically tend to be the students who are pushed out of school due to systemic failures and peer issues such as bullying. So when we look at statistics from GLSEN, and I know that GLSEN was cited earlier, we know very specifically that bullying for LGBTQ youth is a serious problem. In fact, that 82% of those students who identify in any of those categories have had problems with bullying in the last year due to their sexual orientation. We know that 64% of those students feel unsafe at school due to their orientation, and that 32% did not go to school for at least one day because of feeling unsafe. So these statistics are really startling, to be sure, and when you couple them with the alarming statistics about the success rates of our Black and Latino young men and women, we get a very dismal picture about how LGBTQ youth of color, in particular, are unsupported and often underserved in many schools. We believe that addressing these issues is paramount to ensuring student success and ensuring that they have the opportunity to succeed. Perhaps what's most important to note about our efforts to date are the ways in which we've endeavored to establish and sustain a school community and culture that's inclusive, anti-oppressive, and provides students a strong sense of belonging. By design, our school model considers the intersections of race, gender, and sexuality as critical lived experiences that are important part of students' lives. And subsequently, we've put into practice a number of key elements that might have the potential to benefit other schools. They include, I'll wrap up rather quickly. They include a weekly 90-minute class reserved specifically for the critical examination, exploration, and discussion of issues of identity and expression, and that are an important part of the lived experience for our students. In this facilitated space, our students really do have an opportunity to deconstruct and challenge definitions of gender and directly confront some of the prejudices that they experience. For us, that's really important because it serves multiple purposes. It starts to create community and cultivate a sense of belonging across a diversity of students and really acknowledges the multiple identities that they live and represent. And so this is more of a compulsory piece, but it is scheduled as a part of the school day, whereas a lot of times that sort of programming is relegated to after school in many communities. And is the sort of thing that you may, as a young person, have the luck of finding, but not always have the opportunity to see it respected and appreciated by your teachers and staff. And we've also committed very deeply to professional development and restorative practices as a response to both prevent and respond to bullying. Specifically, we look at our restorative practice work at the tier two level in thinking about harm and healing, and providing an opportunity for students who have been harmed to maintain their integrity, for those who have been the responsible to have an opportunity for amends, and then to promote learning that happens in the context of each of those incidents when there is a breach of our norms. The last two points is that for us, cultural responsive education is a key practice as well, and we deliberately focus on that work to really address the interests of our students in the present moment and equip them with the knowledge and skills that they need to identify and fight a range of societal injustices. So we are, as a brand new school, preparing for the initiation and launch and sponsorship of our own GSA. The students who are here with me are members of that founding group, along with a staff person back at the school. And in closing, my experiences as a former social studies teacher, nonprofit leader, school designer, and now executive director for this charter school have collectively shown me that until practices and conversations shift, schools will continue to be alienating places that marginalize entire swaths of students and perpetuate biases that hinder their full potential and individuality. So I appreciate the opportunity to speak with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. My question was going to be if you had a GSA, but you answered that. And you're hoping to have one soon, am
yes,
I right?
Yes, we
do. Yeah. Okay, good. And what grade do you have, ninth grade?
Yes, we have a ninth grade class, an inaugural
and
ninth grade.
When will you get the rest of the grades?
So each year we're enrolling a successive grade until we're fully enrolled, grades 9 to 12. So this year we are with 110 students as our very first class.
Okay, good luck. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Yes.
Gathered council members and the public. My name is Neil Sarkar, and I am an eighth grade student at Eastside Middle School, which is in Councilmember Kalos's district. Our school has a strong gender and sexuality alliance where we actively partake on fundraisers, raise money in the annual AIDS walk, as well as encourage a safe environment in the school. I, along with other members of the Manhattan Leadership Council, which is a group of student leaders in District 2, have written a bill which states that all publicly funded middle school students in the city be required to have a gender and sexuality alliance, which is known as a GSA. We hope that this bill passes through the city council and becomes law by the start of the next school year, which is September 2017. On October 7, 2016, we met with Borough President Gail Brewer to present our idea. Ms. Brewer has expressed her support for the bill and has promised to give us feedback on it. We have also met with Councilmember Kallos, and he also promised to provide his support. Our goal is to eliminate discrimination and harassment towards lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, asexual, and pansexual students. We want students to have a place where they are able to express and discuss their gender identity and sexual orientation freely, as well as raising awareness and spreading their ideas of accepting differences amongst gender expression, identity, and sexuality. A GSA may encompass a restorative justice circle and a safe space program. A safe space is an area where all students can fully express accounts of harassment considering sex, race, sexual orientation, gender identity or expression, cultural background, religious affiliation, age, or physical and mental state without feeling unwelcome, uncomfortable, or unsafe. A restorative justice circle is where students and the instructor gather to gain trust amongst themselves and discuss about their sexuality, gender identity, race, etc. We understand that there will be some controversy relating to a GSA. However, we want to stress that joining your school's GSA is optional and not mandatory. GSA should be implemented in all city-funded schools because research has shown that such a club improves grades, increases attendance, and leads to less cases of harassment and bullying. For example, an investigation by GLSEN found that schools without a GSA reported that 66.5% of students felt unsafe about their sexual orientation compared to schools with a GSA, which reported 54.3%. Furthermore, GLSEN found that 43.2% of students in a school that did not have a GSA felt unsafe compared to 35.7% of students that felt unsafe because of their gender expression in a school with a GSA. In schools with the GSA, GLSEN reported a decrease of 7.9% of students missing at least one day of school in a month when students feel safer and more comfortable in their academic environment, they are better able to absorb the teachings and are less likely to be absent due to fear of harassment and bullying. GSAs make a profound impact on students and can lower the number of cases of bullying, harassment, and discrimination in NYC schools. We need to protect LGBTQ plus youth and other vulnerable students, and I firmly believe that establishing a GSA will help to stop homophobia. Thank you for your time. We hope that you will take our idea into consideration.
Well, thank you very much, Neil, and I'm sure glad that you live in Councilmember Kalos's district because I wouldn't want you running against me for office.
Thank you.
You are very well spoken, and I could have used your statement as my opening statement, actually. So thank you for your testimony, and I have some questions, but we're going to get to the next person, and then we'll come back to you guys, okay?
City Council and members of the public. My name is Katarina Kaur, and I am an eighth grade student at Eastside Middle School as well, and I am a representative in the Manhattan Leadership Council. As New Yorkers, we pride ourselves in our diversity. Many people say that you can come to New York and find every type of person, and in many ways, that applies to our schools too. Each and every student in a New York City public school should be entitled not only to a substantial education, but to a place where they feel safe and protected. In order to do this, it is extremely important to establish a place where students can express their gender or sexuality without feeling persecuted. As a student, I would want to go to a school where I feel safe and accepted. And with a group like this, we can make a step to all schools having that quality. These qualities are the prime focus of the Manhattan Leadership Council. This is a council comprised of middle school students representing their schools and its interests, while also determining an initiative that we should all follow. This year, it was acceptance. So far, we have drafted a bill that we hope to pass, and although we haven't determined anything for sure, we would like each school to receive funding for materials and for all teachers to lead the groups to receive training. As a representative, we think that having your fellow peers in a group rather than a guidance counselor would be much more effective in providing each student a personal approach to their situation. Although guidance counselors can be helpful, as a student, I would feel much more comfortable talking to people I know have similar experiences or have specific training. As a council, we decided that the best group for this matter would be a gender sexuality alliance, which would create a safe space where a student, regardless of their sexuality, gender, race, religion, etc., can come and receive support from fellow peers and teachers, which would enable them to participate in events, educate others, and find help. But it is important to note that this group is completely optional to join. In my school, we have a gender sexuality alliance, and it has been very successful. We conducted fundraisers for the AIDS Walk and for Ally for Needs for Night Foundation. In a study conducted by the American Journal of Public Health, it revealed that students that were questioning or were part of the LGBTQ plus community were twice as likely to commit suicide as heterosexual students their age. But when you want to change, you have to start talking about people as if they are people and not statistics. Middle schoolers are at a very pivotal age, and it is very important for students to know that they are supported. Imagine a young student who is in middle school. Now imagine that this student has come out to his family as bisexual. The student's parents disapprove. The student goes to tell his friends, hoping that he will find support, but instead he gets bullied and has nowhere to go. Think about how this student must be thinking. Their very own parents and friends have turned on him. The student has no one to talk to and no one he can trust. Imagine not having anyone. The student decides to commit suicide. The student has left a burden on his school, on his friends, and on his family. The student had given up. What if we could prevent this? I'm not saying that we will prevent every single LGBTQ plus youth suicide with this group, but I am saying that if we can save at least one life by providing help like this, it is worth it. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Thank you very much, Katarina. That was spectacular also. And I really, really like the idea of you bringing up the fact of young people coming out to their parents, because in some ways, on LGBTQ issues, because in some ways it's what makes it different than other types of bullying. Because oftentimes if you're bullied in another way, for your clothing or for your race or whatever, you may be able to, or most likely would be able to, go home and tell your parents. But oftentimes, LGBT students feel that they have absolutely no one that they can turn to. So that's why I wanted to, and actually wanted to focus this hearing. We put LGBTQ first, you know, but that kind of was my thinking in wanting to do that, so that we can draw that out. And you really hit the nail on the head with that. So thank you very much for your testimony. I do have some questions for the students. One is, when you set out to, you know, to make these GSAs in your schools, did you have opposition? How did it work? Who did you go to? Can you tell me a little bit about the process of how you got to coming here today?
Sure. So both Neil and
I... And is your mic on? I just want to make sure.
I believe so.
The little red light is on?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
So both Neil and I are part of the Manhattan Student Leadership Council, as we've said, and so... At the very beginning of the year, we worked with Superintendent Bonnie Lavoie, and we decided on an initiative that we should all follow. And this year, we decided that it should be acceptance. And so within our council, we did not have any opposition to the ideas. And so far, we have not worked with any parents or any people that would oppose this idea. But within our council, we were deciding between a restorative justice circle or a safe space, and we decided that a GSA would be the best fit idea.
What would be your suggestion to parents who might have concerns about their children joining a group like the one that you're starting, the GSA?
Well, we wanted to stress that joining it was optional, so if the student is interested, then they can come. But you from the GSA, you can learn different perspectives of other people, so it is very helpful to expand your view of other people and other perspectives.
So the last hearing that I held, I had a 14-year-old transgender female-to-male student come in and give testimony. And he told us that he had gone to 7 adults in his schools between middle school and high school, but that no teacher or no adult in the school would help him start the GSA. That was not your experience?
In our school, we've had a GSA. I'm not sure for how long, but I do know that we've had a GSA. And we would be, this GSA would be in accordance with the Equal Access Act, so that no school can deny the a request to start a GSA. But if we were to propose and the bill were to be passed, it would be required for all public middle schools in New York City.
Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what I'm getting at, because I don't think that it's fair that the burden for starting a GSA should be on the students. It's my opinion that that really should be on the adults in the building. And so when I heard that story of that transgender boy, I was very, very affected by it. But actually, he wound up doing fantastically. And he went to a school, it was in Mathspeth High School, and he became the president of his student body overall. So it was really, really wonderful, because he finally found the support that he needed. But you hit the nail on the head again by saying that I think that we need to look at, I don't know that we can do a law. It's one of my frustrations about being the chair of the city council. I can't exactly tell the Department of Education what to do, although sometimes I'd like to, you know. But we can make recommendations to them, and we may be able to pass a resolution, which is advisory to the Department of Education, that we'd like to see something like that happen. So thank you. Councilmember Kallos, you have some questions.
Thank you, Neil and Katarina. Good to see you. What's it like testifying here at the City Council?
Well, I better get used to it, because I want to be on that end.
Great. On this side, you just get to ask questions. You don't have to come up with the answers as often.
Still seems fun.
There you go. And Katarina?
I'll admit it was kind of nerve-wracking.
But there, no one can see it, and just so you know, you're actually on TV, too. So I just wanted to thank you for your leadership on the GSA and also bringing this out to District 2 and working with your superintendent. Absolutely great, and the support. And what's the best way to reach, for folks who are watching on TV or online right now, what is the best way to reach out to your school on Twitter or Instagram? Do you know your Twitter names and things like that? What's the best way for folks to reach out if they'd like to hear from peers on how they can do this at their own schools?
I think the best possible way is to email our principal
or to call us.
And is it dgetz at schools.nyc.gov?
D-G-E-T-Z?
ESMS.net. No, it's dgetz.
Okay. And perfect. And can folks tweet you? I believe it's ESMS_Eagles. Is that? Okay, just so folks can email dgetz at dgetz at schools.nyc.gov. And what other middle schools have you been able to get to join?
So one school, which is really our example, is MAT. They didn't have a GSA, and our GSA, along with some other members of the Leadership Council, we went to their school and helped them institute their GSA by showing examples of what our GSA did to get started. And they use those examples to start their own GSA.
And what have you found for other for children who identify as LGBTQ and allies? How has their experience changed at Eastside Middle School since you started your GSA?
So I think it really helped them like find support from people. So like our GSA advisor, he's really strong at working with people and making them feel safe and comfortable in their environment. So I think they've found support from the staff and the students.
And tell me about how many kids participated in the AIDS Walk. That's actually something I used to do back Back in 1994, still kind of young, but for you, what year were we folks born?
2003.
So back in 1994, I used to do the AIDS walk from the Bronx High School of Science. And so how many kids are participating? How much are you raising through the AIDS walk?
So we have about 15 to 20 students in our GSA, but we have students from the entire school participating in the AIDS walk, and this year we had a little bit more than 30 students, and we had a couple of teachers join us as well. And we do fundraising in our school through bake sales, and the students doing the AIDS walk, they also do their own fundraisers, and a couple of our students were actually star walkers, which means that they raised more than $1,000 for the AIDS walk.
And in terms of it, we talked a little bit about it with the superintendent, but what do you think the right budget is for a school, and what would you want to spend that money on at Eastside Middle School, and what would you want to spend it at some of your peer, what some of the other middle schools that your friends go to?
So I think we would budget it for like how many students are at the school, so that if the teachers don't make kids go to the GSA just to gain more funding for the school. So we would do it by school, and that would be around $5,000 per school. And like the superintendent touched on it, it would be on materials and then sometimes like training teachers.
Okay. And I think one of the conversations we'd had is, and I think I gave you a little bit of an answer, but I'll ask the tough question anyway. Why can't we just make every single school have a GSA?
Well, because there is going to be some opposition against it, but you have to like slow steps to gain acceptance with the parents and with the students to make a GSA.
Absolutely. So hopefully folks will see you as role models. Hopefully folks can reach out to your school. Principals and faculty and parents can help spread it to every single school. And is it just for middle schools, or do you think high schools should do it, or grade schools? Where should we have GSAs?
So far right now, many high schools do have GSAs, and we want to make sure that middle schools have GSAs because we feel that that's a better age to start having a GSA in a school. Mm-hmm. But we haven't focused or talked about yet whether or not we should have it in lower grades, but we feel that middle school would be a better time to have one before high school.
Perfect. And there's a couple of members here on this side of the table who went to the Bronx High School of Science. I went there, Council Member Chin went there. Any interest from either of you in going to Bronx Science for high school?
So I'm still deciding between Stuyvesant and Bronx Science.
I'll plug Bronx Science. A whole bunch of council members from there. I don't think we have any council members from Stuyvesant right now, for what it's worth. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you to this panel for coming in today. And we're going to call our next panel up, Jillian Weiss from the Transgender Legal Defense and Education Fund, Eliza Bard from GLSEN, Dr. Elizabeth Payne from Queering Education Research Institute at Hunter College, and then we'll do Gina Miller from Advocates for Children. Okay, so I have to swear you in. If you would please raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear or affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, and to answer council member questions honestly?
I do.
Okay, who would like to start?
Would you like to start?
I want to see you can start. You're done.
Okay. Good afternoon, Chairman Drum and members of the City Council and members of the public. It is an incredible honor and pleasure.
Just before you start, I meant to make an announcement. If you intend to give testimony, you have to fill out a form, so please be sure that you've done that. I know there are some people here who I thought were going to give testimony, but we don't have your forms. So if you intend to testify, please fill out that form and then they'll get it to us. Thank you, I'm sorry.
No problem. It is an incredible pleasure to be here today. My name is Eliza Byard, and I am the executive director of GLSEN. GLSEN is a national organization that champions LGBT issues in K-12 education at the national, state, and local level. And for more than 25 years now, we have worked with educators, students, policymakers, parents, and concerned members of the community around the country to improve school climate and make our nation's schools safer and more affirming places for every student. As a native New Yorker and a New York City public school parent, I am particularly proud of our long history of partnership with New York City to improve its schools. I have written testimony to submit, which contains a number of suggestions regarding the amplification of existing interventions in New York City schools to continue the work happening here truly support and affirm every student in this school system. And I will just make a few points. We have heard such important testimony in detail here today, but a couple of points that I'd like to add to those that have been made to amplify a couple of points. New York City is truly at the forefront of efforts nationally to support and affirm LGBT youth across the system. Yet we all can tell from testimony here today and from personal experience how much more still needs to be done. To give you a sense of the urgency of these issues nationally, I would simply point to a couple of things. In August, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention released the first ever national data from the Youth Risk Behavior Survey regarding the experiences of lesbian, gay, bisexual, and questioning students across the country. Our goal is to get transgender students included in the 2017 administration. But I'd like to point out two things. One is, in the national sample, LGB and questioning students represented 11% of the national student sample. It is probably an underreporting of that number. And I think it's important for us to note that LGBT and questioning youth probably make up about 12 to 13% of the national student body. And of course, as we all know, these students represent young people from every community, every rank of life, every identity that makes up this great nation of ours, as well as their sexual orientation, gender expression, and gender identity. Despite, and on top of that number, the sheer numbers of students that we are talking about that are affected by these issues, I want to underscore how important it is that we put the resources and attention on LGBT youth. Because when we look at the disparity of experience represented in the YRBS, it is significant. LGBTQ students are 3 times more likely than their non-LGBT peers to be raped, 5 times more likely to be using illegal drugs, and 4 times more likely to attempt suicide. And as the National CDC talks about this data, they point to the incredible importance of stigma in creating these added barriers to youth achievement and well-being. So I would simply say that here in New York City, we have the elements of a national model that we must build on. I am extremely proud of GLSEN's role in helping the city to develop the Respect for All program, which was the very first and still one of the only evaluated professional development programs for educators to make a difference in the lives of LGBT youth. We must continue to build on that program. GLSEN has received funds to further augment the city's work by providing our Ready, Set, Respect elementary school toolkit on these issues, produced in collaboration with the National Association of Elementary School Principals and the National Association for the Education of Young Children, free of charge to every single elementary school in the city. And I also hope that as New York City continues to augment its data collection and reporting efforts, that it will collaborate with the state to point out how under new ESSA reporting requirements at the national level, we can continue to provide leadership on LGBT issues by making sure that these conditions for learning are centrally understood as part of our effort to make our schools truly serve every young person in this country. I will submit written testimony with other information about how we stand ready to support the city. I thank you so much for the opportunity to be here today with my esteemed colleagues and everyone here doing this work. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, please.
Good afternoon. My name is Jillian Weiss. I am transgender rights attorney and executive director of the Transgender Legal Defense and Education Fund here in New York City. I've spent much of my career litigating on behalf of transgender people with regard to discrimination, and it's my life's work to press forward on that fight to create equal protection under the law. And this effort, this hearing to address what is happening with students in the New York City school system is extremely important to that effort. I'd like to thank Councilmember Drum as the education chair for bringing us together today to shed light on this issue. I'm going to tell you a little bit about what we have learned at the Transgender Legal Defense and Education Fund, which was founded in 2003, so we've been around for 13 years. We're committed to ending discrimination based on gender identity and expression and achieving equality for trans people through impact litigation, service partnerships with the private sector, and education initiatives to ensure that transgender people, including students in schools, can participate fully in the social, cultural, and economic life of this city and other places. There's been a lot of progress here in the city, but that does not mean that our task is at an end. School bullying is extremely pervasive. We've heard a number of statistics. We've heard testimony. One statistic that stands out for me is that more than 50% of transgender youth will have attempted suicide by their 20th birthday. As a former educator myself, this is completely intolerable. It's intolerable to see it happening. We must take action. I would say that transgender students probably make up 1% of your population, so that means there's a lot of transgender students in your schools. We heard a lot about readiness factors today. We heard about voluntary efforts. We heard about informing students. All these things are good. We need to move forward. We need to get data on how many transgender students there are in schools, middle schools, as well as high schools. I've submitted written testimony with information about some events that we have taken in our intake process. People call us. But I want to point out that it's not just students who need to be informed. It's also teachers and administrators particularly. There's a reluctance to report to administrators, partly because there's a culture of impunity in the New York City school system. I myself represented a teacher in the New York City school system who was in the process of planning a gender transition. And when they reached out to a faculty organizer of the school's pride group, they were immediately outed. Information about them was given to other students, to students, to teachers, to administrators. They were called weirdo, schizophrenic, fairy, words I don't want to use here. Mm-hmm. And that increased over time. As an example of the kind of thing that occurred, they grabbed the teacher under the crotch and physically assaulted that teacher while singing a vulgar song. When it was reported to the principal, my client was told that they were overreacting and they should drop the complaint. Fortunately, they did not, and ultimately that resulted in a settlement of that matter and a confidentiality clause. A lot of these cases are getting swept under the rug because of that kind of confidentiality that complainants are forced to agree to. And so people are, young people are being abused every day. We hear their cries. We want to make sure that the Department of Education, in creating the Respect for All program, which is wonderful, moves forward to create a larger culture of inclusion for trans young people and in each of our 1,800 schools, and that we find out how many transgender and gender nonconforming students we have through data gathering. And so I'd like to thank you, Councilmember Drum, and the other members of the council, for allowing me to come here and testify today. I want to make sure that we have a lasting legacy of inclusion that will stay with our young people for the rest of their lives as they grow to become the citizens who will make up the fabric of our lives in this great city. So let's take action now. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, please.
I'm Dr. Elizabeth Payne. I'm director of the Queering Education Research Institute and interim of the LGBT Social Science and Public Policy Center at Hunter College, CUNY. I was here in 2014 to testify in your hearing, and much has changed around the country since 2014, but there are a lot of things in our schools that have not changed. And one of those is the ways we go about addressing bullying. So I want to talk about that just briefly, and then I also want to talk about some studies that we've done on the implementation of the Dignity for All Students Act. So Query has been very involved in the Dignity for All Students Act before it even passed in both houses. And we were on the implementation committees on the task force, the professional development committee, and the diversity committee for the statewide implementation. And we've also been looking at surveys and interviews around the state, assessing how it is the dignity is being implemented. And I will share a little bit of that data with you, even though it is not concentrated specifically on New York City. So mainstream educational conversations on LGBT students and bullying are dominated by risk management, and tolerance discourses. LGBT youth are understood as easy targets, victims, and different in ways that demand their peers and teachers express tolerance and empathy. The students who target them, the bullies, are understood as individuals who need school intervention to correct their antisocial behavior. This bully-victim binary dominates both cultural understandings of bullying and school focus on addressing it. The limitations of this mainstream narrative about queer youth and their school experiences are multiple, but the bottom line is the problem is understood almost solely in terms of social and emotional development of individual youth, the bullies and the victims. Questions about how schools are providing conditions in which bullying can flourish are not explored, and school culture often escapes examination. Additionally, there is little attention paid to the persistent patterns of peer targeting over time. Students whose genders and sexualities do not align with cultural expectations for their biological sex are the most consistent targets of bullying and harassment in schools. The further youth fall from idealized forms of heteromasculinity and heterofemininity, the more vulnerable they are to bullying, as well as more severe forms of violence. LGBT youth are often the most vulnerable within this system. So for long-term change, we must move away from solely focusing on individual bullies and victims. A sociological framing of bullying changes the problem of in-schools violence from the product of pathological individuals who are ill-adjusted in society to interactional reproduction of larger structural inequalities. This reframing is significant because it attends to the social contexts in which bullying occurs and asks questions about the meanings produced through bullying interactions. New York's Dignity for All Students Act is notable because it asks us to address school culture. That is what we must do. However, it's up to the discretion of individual districts to develop a proactive strategy for this. In order to understand the progress of dignity implementation, over a two-year period, we conducted a number of surveys and interviews with DACs, or Dignity Act Coordinators, around the state. Overall, this research has indicated that New York schools have focused most of their attention on creating systems of reporting for bullying and harassment and investigation procedures. The findings do not include any meaningful engagement with proactive efforts to develop positive, inclusive school culture. More specific findings include Dignity Act coordinators are receiving training on codes of conduct, avoiding lawsuits, the language in the legislation, the definition of a bullying act, how to complete forms for incident reporting, and responsibilities for reporting. They are not being trained on recognizing bias-based incidents or working with diverse populations of students. No interview respondents reported that their DASA professional development focused on proactively creating supportive environments or offered significant education on LGBT students and families in schools. When interview respondents were asked about their school's proactive efforts to develop positive school culture, most educators did not know what a proactive approach might look like. Common approaches to curriculum changes were to teach tolerance or empathy. When asked about integrating diversity content, and particularly LGBT content, into academic curriculum, most participants could not share examples of that happening within their school. Resistance or hesitation over explicitly recognizing and addressing the needs of LGBT youth and families seems to be occurring at both the state and local levels. So the Dignity Act is exceptional when we compare it to other states' anti-bullying laws, particularly because it does have this proactive element in it. However, through our research, it's clear that educators did not understand what proactive meant. We believe that steps need to be taken to encourage education that foregrounds proactive rather than reactive approaches through professional development and pre-service teacher preparation. I just would like to briefly add as well that we're seeing curricular pushes around the country, most notably in California. In New York State, LGBT students have been most recognized in the formal curriculum through HIV education. In New York State, HIV education is not required to be medically accurate. We have done a recent study in 2016 on the materials being used to teach HIV education in New York State schools. We found that the majority of the materials were outdated. The average age for a material being taught was 12 years, with some materials currently used in the classroom dating to the 1980s. So, with the sole representation of LGBT students in the former curriculum often being in HIV, the fact that it's not required to be medically accurate is a real problem, and we would like to encourage the council to move that New York City HIV education be required to be medically accurate.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Next, please.
Good afternoon. Thank you for having me here. My name is Jenna Miller. I'm an Equal Justice Works Fellow in the School Justice Project at Advocates for Children of New York, where I represent students who are bullied and accused of bullying, with a special focus on LGBTQ students and students with disabilities. Each year, we help thousands of parents navigate the education system, and we receive numerous calls on our helpline about the New York City Department of Education's failure to address bullying. A disproportionate number of LGBTQ students and students with disabilities, as well as students who fall under other vulnerable categories, such as national origin, religion, and English language learner status, are the targets of bullying. Federal, New York State, and New York City law require schools to intervene and prevent bullying. However, the August 31st State Attorney General report relating to DASA was consistent with our organization's experiences fielding complaints from parents and professionals from schools throughout New York City. They say that schools are failing to report, investigate, prevent, and address bullying, harassment, and discrimination. The DOE's apparent noncompliance with DASA's reporting requirements prevents building truly positive school climates because it undermines identifying and allocating resources to schools with staff and students in need of intervention and support. We offer several recommendations to the City Council to address this significant issue. First, we request that the City Council urge the DOE to better train school staff and district leaders on what constitutes bullying, how to prevent it, how to appropriately investigate it and intervene it and stop it, and how to provide supports to students who are both bullied and doing the bullying. It's critical that the DOE better train school staff on school staff harassment of students too. Too often in our work, we hear about overburdened and under-resourced school personnel who provoke, threaten, and otherwise harass students with behavioral challenges and push them out of school instead of providing them with the supports that they need to succeed. We also strongly encourage the City Council and the Mayor to expand investment in improving school culture and climate. Bullying is sometimes due to undiagnosed and untreated mental illness that must be addressed in order to curb the behavior. There's peer-reviewed medical research that children who were considered to be engaged in bullying are more than three times as likely to experience depression, anxiety, and attention deficit disorder. The research suggests that if schools fail to appreciate that bullying is often a symptom of underlying mental health issues, many of our students on both sides of this conflict dynamic will not be protected. We ask that City Council urge the DOE to recognize this reality by ensuring that schools prioritize assessment of mental health issues and referral for necessary services when trying to resolve bullying issues. We also ask City Council press the administration to adopt and implement the Mayor's Leadership Team on School Climate and Discipline's recommendations on mental health. Furthermore, we call on City Council to urge the Mayor and the DOE to set forth a long-term strategic plan to fund and scale up and implement restorative practices throughout city schools. Aligned with contemporary research, DOSR requires school districts to develop guidelines that use a progressive model, not zero tolerance through automatic suspension to address bullying. Strategic financial investments and planning will enable the DOE to develop and implement age-appropriate responses, interventions, discipline, and education that varies according to the nature of the behavior, the age, and the particular history of each student as required under DASA. Additionally, we ask that City Council recommend that the DOE list the name of the Respect for All coordinator at each school on the homepage of every school's website. This will ensure that every school appoints a Respect for All coordinator in the first place, and it will make it easier to report bullying and harassment. Finally, while DASA requires school districts to report only material incidents of bullying to the state, schools are also required to log all instances of bullying in the DOE's OR system and promptly address them. We ask the City Council to strongly recommend that district superintendents and central DOE staff better provide oversight of schools' data collection and analysis of bullying incidents. This will help the DOE to strategically allocate necessary resources. Thanks very much for the opportunity to testify. We appreciate you having us here today.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And did Advocates for Children just create a position dealing specifically, is that
yes.
You?
Yes, that's me.
Okay, congratulations to you, and I look forward to continuing to work with you on these issues. Very glad to hear that they did that, so very good. I want to throw a question out there. You know, we've been very proud to have passed, at least I was, because it was my legislation, demographics reporting legislation last Thursday. Waiting for the mayor's signature, but I do expect the mayor to sign the legislation. How important is demographic data collection to understanding what's going on in our schools, number one? And number two, in negotiations with the Department of Education for LGBT demographic reporting, we moved the age to 14. I felt it was a bit of a compromise because, and I wonder what Jillian's opinion is on this, because I do know young people at as young as the age of four who have identified as transgender. And so I just wanted to see if anybody wanted to comment on the demographics piece of it.
Yes, I'd like to say that I think the demographics are extremely important because if we don't know that people are there, there's no way to advocate for them and to channel resources. As you said, people know when they're quite young about gender identity and transgender issues as well as sexual orientation. And so if those students go into school and there's no way to identify they're there and we think, oh, well, school children of that age don't really have those feelings or those thoughts and so on, which is, I think, a common refrain, then we wind up ignoring what is happening to those students and pretending that they don't exist. And then that's when they're ripe for bullying. That's when they're ripe for all kinds of mistreatment, both from students and administration. So I think, you know, I understand you have to make political compromises and you did what you had to do, so thank you for doing that. I think that bill is extremely important. I would like to see demographic collection, you know, at other levels as well.
And I really appreciate the point. I think it's absolutely critical to remember that what's measured is what matters. And so having disaggregatable data at all levels is incredibly important. The one note I would add of caution with respect to this is that collecting data on LGBT youth in a thoughtful way is still absolutely critical because we have to be sure that the collection of the data is handled in a way that does not out them. To parents, friends, or school personnel. That is an issue that we have been in communication with the council with about the legislation, and we stand ready. Our research department works with the CDC, with other state agencies, to help with questions of data collection in a way that respects the safety, privacy of the youth involved, and also crafts questions so as to get accurate information. I would urge you also, there are other ways to collect data that makes it disaggregatable in other city processes. The New York City School Survey is one way that we could get demographic data confidentially and anonymously, and we should have questions there about sexual orientation, gender expression, and gender identity. I would also say that I just want to underscore that having that data about students, but also having it about adult professionals in the system is absolutely critical. And I just would like to, Dr. Weiss's point about discrimination against school personnel is a huge piece of this puzzle as well.
So one of the things we're continuing to talk with the administration about is the student survey. So we're hopeful we'll be able to make some movement on that as well. I also want to say to all the advocates who are here, I'm very proud to have partnered with Margaret Chin on mixed race data collection as well, and also are the top 30 groups in terms of nationality, ethnicities, and languages spoken. We passed legislation together, we did that, and I was proud to partner with her on that. And for the first time, we'll be collecting information on many of the Asian groups that were not disaggregated in the past, Arab groups, Dominican groups, et cetera, so forth and so on. So that legislation was comprehensive. There is, though, in the LGBT demographic stuff, some exclusions for departments and for agencies. And so I would really like to have people think through how we go about, because there is a provision in the legislation for all agencies, including the criminal justice agencies, which were primarily exempted from the law, about how they're going to go about doing data collection as well, particularly on LGBT. And the idea was that we need to put some of those safety concerns in there before we do that data collection. But I do believe, particularly in cases where there may be transgender folks who want to go into the transgender unit at Rikers Island, let's say, for their own protection, early identification as being a transgender person, maybe even at the precinct level, or certainly when they're at the receiving end of when they go into Rikers or whatever, might be helpful. So I think those are discussions that we need to have moving forward about how we deal with those other agencies, and that should occur with the other agencies within 5 years once this legislation is done. The other piece of the demographic legislation that we did was that all agencies will be trained in the collection of the demographic information. So I think that was an important component in there as well, because I think just by virtue of the training of staff how to do it sends a clear message that these are important groups of people to all of us. So I want to thank you for coming in, all of you on the panel today, and I'm going to ask that we stop with this panel here. I have a little bit of a dilemma. This room needs to be used at 4 o'clock, so I'm going to ask that we move into the committee room, and we will call our next panel in the committee room. And that next panel will be Evan Bernstein from the ADL, Jordan Greenberg from the Arab American Family Support Center, Saif Schumann from the Arab American Family Support Center, Jordan Greenberg, Arab American Family Support Center, and Dr. Debbie Almentasser from the Muslim Community Network. And we'll convene in there in about 5 minutes. Okay, thank you. Thank you. It's okay, don't worry. Oh, my hearing's all wrong.
This is an education meeting. I'm trying to fight for Clay Street.
Oh, okay.
So we finally got a meeting.
Oh, good, good.